American novelist Michael Corrieta once said that we understand tornadoes scientifically, yet they seem supernatural. Randomness makes them feel supernatural. So today we'll try to understand what randomness really is and how it connects the dots in the universe. A clinical definition of randomness is the state of lacking principal pattern or organization. There is unpredictability associated with randomness, and when we try to statistically measure randomness, we talk about uncertainty, which really has an origin from quantum mechanics. Information can be used to create order. Information can be used to create order. This is an important statement, and we'll later on understand why. So, to give you a qualitative idea about randomness, let me cite an example from my own life. So later this year, we developed a device called OxyServe. So OxyServe is an oxygen conservation device. It can save around 60 to 70% of medical oxygen. It can reduce the risk of hypoxemia and hyperoxemia, and it can monitor the patient's parameter. So when we developed this device, it was quite successful. We made a sound impact with our work. We were featured in a number of media outlets and stuff. Department of Science and Technology supported our work. We CERN selected our idea as top 5 innovation across the globe. But an important question is not why we came up with this, but how. Why we came up with this is very obvious. There was a factor of empathy involved and a certain scientific challenge. But more interesting aspect is how we came up with this. So in this picture, you can see astronaut Rakesh Sharma on the top, and on the bottom is astronaut Fred Gregory. We all know who is astronaut Rakesh Sharma. Astronaut Fred Gregory is 3-time Apollo astronaut and former deputy head of NASA. So last year we were working on projects related to human spaceflight research, and a small part of the project was optimization of oxygen consumption by astronaut when they go for a spacewalk. So we thought that we can use the technology here in healthcare when there was an oxygen crisis, and we successfully managed to do it. But the most challenging part of the project was to predict a PID algorithm which controls the respiratory rate and oxygen saturation. Just because of the sheer number of random variables that were involved, human body is a complex system. It doesn't respond in a similar fashion given a similar gradient. But we eventually trained it using a machine learning model and managed to come up with a successful yet a safe technique to do it. Now, when we talk about randomness, let's see why it is really important. So when we try to understand randomness within a system, it enables us to look at some of the unsolved problems, and it establishes the connection between different fields. More importantly, laws of physics are not sufficient to predict the dynamics of a complex system. In those cases, we need something called as chaos theory. So chaos theory is an attempt to find order in chaos. Systems whose dynamics are highly sensitive to initial conditions, in those cases, we really need chaos theory. And chaos theory has huge application. Chaos theory has application in weather prediction, climate change, social interaction, how you connect with people on social media, turbulence in fluid dynamics, etc. But an out-of-box example of chaos theory mathematics is this. So there was a study in Journal of Family Psychology in which they took a sample of around 100 couples, and they were trying to predict the divorce rate using chaos theory mathematics. When they followed the couples for a long period of time, they found out that they were correct up to 87%. So this is how powerful is chaos theory. Now, chaos theory is understanding of something which is intellectually intangible on the scale of human interpretation. So first understand something which is tangible, intellectually tangible on human interpretation, like truth and observable scientific truth. So the approach of science is to understand the universe through rationality, and the approach of art is to understand the universe through emotions. For example, a coin has 2 sides, a dice has 6, but truth is a sphere. So when we understand truth and we use rationality to describe the universe, there are 2 emerging school of thoughts. The first school of thought is something like the patterns emerging out of randomness are just coincidental, and the second is no, they are not. Randomness is deterministic. Talking about first school of thought, it goes on like universe was born out of random events and chaos and all forms of existing pattern and orderly structure that we see, which are really pleasing to our eyes and which are easier for human interpretation, they are nothing but coincidence. And you can see, for example, if you look at these geographical figures which has a resemblance with human anatomy, you might think that, yeah, we might see some pattern, but they always need not to make sense. So yes, it is possible to see pattern in randomness, but we need not to invest our intellectual faculties to decipher those patterns. And it is true in cases of complex systems like weather prediction, functioning of an economy, movement of cell cytoplasm, etc., where there are sheer number of random variables involved and higher order differential equations. So these patterns really doesn't need to make sense every time. Now let's transition towards the second school of thought, and we will use a mathematical tool to do that. Now we will challenge our own precision, our own ability to extract a truth. Let me introduce you to Kurt Gödel. So Kurt Gödel was an Austrian mathematician and logician who came up with Gödel's incompleteness theorem. And this changed our perspective about the structure of mathematics in general. So in mathematics, we have fundamentals called axioms. We derive theorems out of those axioms and we prove a mathematical truth out of it. But Gödel's theorem says that no consistent system of axioms is capable of proving all the truths in mathematics, which means that the mathematical structure in itself is inherently inconsistent. The mathematical systems are not continuous. There are possible conjunctures, and yes, we do have a long list of conjunctures, which means that there is a big difference between what is truth and what can be proven. Now let's talk about prime numbers, because prime numbers represent both order and chaos. So if you arrange all the numbers in a certain way and you mark all the prime numbers, well, they don't seem to have any pattern. They look very chaotic and very random as they are, the nature of prime number. But if you arrange all the numbers in a spiral and mark all the prime numbers, then voila, when you scale it out, you see there's a pattern in prime numbers, and this is not supposed to happen. Prime numbers are the most random thing that we could ever encounter. So this changes our perspective about the structure of universe, that from second law of thermodynamics, we understand the disorder of the system would increase with time, the entropy of the system would increase with time, but the complexity would reach a certain threshold and then it would decrease. Then there would be an emergence of simplicity within our systems. Talking about second school of thought, there are two stories regarding Albert Einstein. So once Albert Einstein wrote a letter to Max Born in which he said that quantum theory yields much, but it hardly brings us close to the old secret, and I'm convinced that God doesn't play dice. God doesn't play dice. Well, this is a philosophically extreme but rather an important statement. It is basically his disagreement with the fact that at least on atomic level, the nature of universe is not totally random. Things are not happening just by chance. So there might be an existence of an infinitely precise determinism even on events on such a scale. Now, another story which connects Einstein's idea about randomness is regarding migratory bird patterns. So Albert Einstein once met a biologist named Carl von Frisch. Carl von Frisch was investigating the behavior of honeybees and migratory birds when they are able to move thousands of kilometers with an extreme precision. So birds do it effectively using the polarization pattern of light which is scattered in the sky, for which Carl von Frisch eventually won a Nobel Prize. But way before that, Albert Einstein made a statement that it is thinkable that the behavior of honeybees and migratory birds might lead us to understanding of a fundamental phenomena which we don't know yet. Cut to 70 years after that, around in 2008, researchers indeed revealed that birds have a magnetic sense within their brain, and the origin of this magnetic sense on a molecular level is really due to quantum entanglement and quantum randomness. Now, complex biological systems can really be condensed into a simple one. For example, during my work at Harvard, I was working with Coase-Green simulation of polymer knots. And for example, DNA is a knot, and it is a polymer knot. So the breaking of DNA might lead to certain diseases like cancer or Alzheimer. So dynamics of these topological of these molecular knots is really important, and dynamics of these molecular knots, which is extremely random, but they can be understood via topology, which is an extremely opposite branch of mathematics, and it gives us important features about those knots. Now, initially I made a statement that information can be used to create order. So let's see how. Let's talk about the problem of Maxwell Lehman. So Maxwell Lehman was a thought experiment, rather a puzzle put forward by James Clerk Maxwell in 1867. And it took physicists more than 120 years to come up with a feasible solution. So the problem is something like this. Let's take two boxes isolated from the universe and connect them with an inlet. Close the inlet. Let's introduce a super intelligent being called Maxwell Lehman in between the two boxes. The superintelligence of Maxwell Demon is attributed to the fact that he can distinguish the velocity of these particles. And what Demon would do, when we will fill these boxes randomly with fast and slow moving particles, the Demon would allow the slow moving particle to go from left to right, but it would stop the fast moving particles, and it does the vice versa for the opposite direction. As a result of it, all the fast moving particles get collected on one side and all the slow moving particles on the other side. Their velocity is nothing but their kinetic energy, is nothing but their temperature. So there is a creation of temperature gradient between two boxes, and we can extract energy out of these two boxes indefinitely. Remember, while doing this, Demon does no work, so we are literally able to extract energy out of thin air. So this is the violation of second law of thermodynamics as well as energy conservation principle. Because initially the entropy of the system was high, it was a disordered system, but entropy of the system has decreased, it has become more ordered. So people were not able to roll around their head with this problem when around 120 years ago, after 120 years, Shannon came up with information theory. Well, information theory establishes the relation between information of a system with its thermodynamic parameters like entropy or enthalpy. So the solution is something like this. The Demon is able to bifurcate this system, bifurcate it into two parts because of the information it has about the velocity of the particles. And in order to have information about the velocity, you need to feed this information in the brain or the operating system of this Demon. And that process requires energy. So this is really the solution of the Maxwell-Demon problem, because when the entropy of this system is decreasing, the entropy of the operating system of Demon is increasing. So information, which is a quantum of randomness, can be used to create order. So this is the reason why we make timetable. This is the reason why we go to a therapist. This is the reason we are able to cure certain genetic diseases, or we are able to reduce the noise in a signal. So you'll ask how much of randomness is deterministic. Well, it doesn't matter. When we try to find out how much of randomness is deterministic, it enables us to explore the interconnection between two fields. For example, psychology, which is a really complex field of social interaction, it has an intrinsic connection with signal detection theory, which is a part of electronics. Space engineering has a connection with origami. Molecular biology, as I told you, has a connection with topology. Thermodynamics has a connection with information theory. And spaceflight behavioral studies has a connection with healthcare, something which we did with OxySurf, and many more. So where do we really stand between two schools of thoughts? Well, we stand somewhere in between, where things are not extremely random, neither they are extremely deterministic. So what is the real conclusion? So outside the periphery of scientific discussion, every attempt to find out why and how much in randomness is associated to a single desire, the desire and curiosity to find the meaning of disorder and order, or simply the meaning of life, right? And we know that all the discriminations, all the fields that we have created, all the distinctions and all the discriminations created by humans in order to make sense with things around them are very synthetic, they are very inorganic, they are not natural. Which means all the concepts of like morality is just like concept of time. It is man-made just to keep things in order. So nature doesn't know what is physics, nature doesn't know what is art, nature doesn't know what is mathematics. Nature has no distinction, nature has no discrimination. The only thing which nature has is entropy. So in this way, we encounter the randomness through chaos theory and eventually find a meaning of order and disorder, or the meaning of life. So if you will ask that what is the meaning of life, well, that's the most beautiful part about it, that life has no meaning, which makes it super malleable. You can mold it in any way you want. You can do anything with your life and you give up meaning to it and it will make sense. So that is all about how, why, and where the curiosity to understand randomness is leading our civilization to a future which is random, but ideas which are ordered. Thank you so much.